figuring out your study strategy in med school or university can be very difficult. Should you go to lecture in person or online? Should you study your lectures beforehand? Do you really need a textbook? This can all be a mess to figure out and can take a very long time to perfect. So today I'm going to talk about what is, in my opinion, the best workflow for med school. If you're new here, my name is Joseph, and I'm a third year medical student at the Royal College of Surgeons in Ireland. So I've just finished up my preclinical years of med school. If you don't know, med school is generally divided up into preclinical years and clinical years. Throughout these preclinical years, I feel like I've come across a workflow that I've perfected in that it keeps me organized and it keeps me caught up and prepared for the upcoming lectures. And that's what I want to share with you in this video. But first, if you're into videos like this about studying and productivity, make sure to hit the subscribe button and the bell icon for notifications. So before we get into it, I just want to preface this by saying my exact workflow isn't going to work for everyone. Everyone's different and they're going to need to incorporate different things that work for them. So it's best to experiment and find out what works for you. However, there are some things I'm going to talk about, like the use of Anki cards, which take advantage of spaced repetition and active recall. Those things are supported by the research literature and are generally applicable to everyone. So if you haven't tried those things out, I would highly recommend it. So my workflow is broken up into 7 steps. The last 2 are optional, and whether or not you do them depends on whether or not your program is pass-fail or if it's graded. I'll get more into why that is later in the video. All right, so the first thing that I do every single day throughout the semester is I do my Anki review cards first thing in the morning. If you didn't know, Anki is a flashcard app that uses a spaced repetition algorithm to bring back the information that you've already learned at regular intervals. Doing this helps consolidate the information and helps you to remember that information for much longer. If you're interested in learning more about Anki, I already made a video about it, which I'll link to right up here. In my opinion, doing your Anki review cards is probably the most tiresome and longest step of this entire process. So because of that, I like to get it out of the way first thing in the morning. It's also the most important step because it's that daily repetition and review that helps consolidate the information and put it into your long-term memory. For that reason, I think it's best to do first thing in the morning so that you don't forget about it or run out of time. Anki can be a really useful tool, and if used properly, can help you memorize an insane amount of information. If you're not doing the Anki review cards, you're not taking advantage of the spaced repetition and active recall that makes Anki so effective to begin with. So this part's really important. Please don't skip out on it. So the second step of my workflow is organizing the topics that I need to know. So I want to get an idea of what I'm generally going to learn, and I want to get a list of topics going that are going to show up in my upcoming lectures. This is going to involve me looking at the lectures that I have coming up tomorrow and getting a general idea of what's going to be in there. So this is one of my schedules from last semester. And what I would do here, so let's say it was a Monday and I was looking at the next Tuesday, I would go ahead and just look at the title of these lectures and get an idea of what kind of topics are going to be in these lectures. And then I'd write it down in a list off to the side here. So I can see that we're going to be learning about head injuries, stroke, brain tumors, Parkinson's disease, breast cancer management, head injury and brain tumors, and then MS and neurodegenerative disorders. So I would just write all those topics down onto another list so I have an idea of what's gonna be coming up. So now that I have an idea of what I'm going to be learning in tomorrow's lecture, I'm actually gonna go ahead and try to learn that information ahead of time. And I'm gonna learn that information from a third party resource. Third party meaning not from the lecture or from the lecture slides. In my experience, medical school lectures can be engaging and have a lot of practical, important information, but also they tend to be disorganized and can be a little bit harder to learn from, especially when it's a new topic that's completely foreign to you. For this reason, I like to learn from third-party resources because they tend to be better organized and can be a little bit easier if you don't really know what's going on. For my pathology lectures, I use the Pathoma textbook, and for my pharmacology and microbiology lectures, I use Sketchy Pharm and Micro. So just for example here, I wrote down that my first lecture is on head injuries. So I'm gonna head over to Pathoma, which covers pathology topics, and I'm gonna look for their video on head injuries. So I can see here that in 7.5, it's trauma in the central nervous system. So it'll probably cover head injuries. And so I'm gonna go ahead and watch the corresponding video on trauma in the central nervous system. So at this point, learning from the third party resource, I'm not actually taking any notes. I'm just sitting there watching the video or reading the book and trying to absorb as much information as possible. The actual learning and consolidation will come next. So my fourth step is using pre-made Anki cards based off of the third-party resource I just used. After learning the information I need to know from that third-party resource, I'm gonna need a way to make the information stick, or else I'll just forget about it in a couple of days, maybe even hours. So how I'm gonna get the information to stick is using the power of active recall and spaced repetition via Anki. Now you could go ahead and make your own Anki cards, But if you're using third-party resources, there's already a ton of pre-made Anki cards out there that are available to you for free. I personally use the Anking Anki deck, which is a fantastic resource if you're in medical school. It pretty much has pre-made Anki cards for every single resource that I use. So just continuing on with our previous example, if I just watched a video for trauma in the neurology section of Pathoma, I'm gonna go ahead and activate the pre-made cards for that. So what I'm gonna do here is open up Anking, browse, and look for the Pathoma cards over here, for the neurology chapter down here, find the trauma section, which is right here, and I'm gonna use Command A and Command J just to activate those cards. And now I can go and review those cards, which will help me to consolidate that information that I just learned. Now, after I've committed all that information to memory, using the power of active recall, I'm gonna go ahead and watch or attend that lecture that I've been preparing for this whole time. So I would have watched that Pathoma video on brain trauma, then I would have done the pre-made Anki cards for the Pathoma video on brain trauma, and then the next day, I would have attended that lecture on brain trauma. I really like this way of doing things because I show up to the lecture already knowing most of the information. This makes the lecture a lot more digestible and I'm not scrambling to write down notes. I can just sit down, relax, enjoy the lecture, as well as participate in it. This also makes the lecture a great time to highlight areas that I might have had trouble with when I was reviewing the lecture beforehand. Now, for all of these reasons, I think pre-studying for the lecture that you're about to attend is probably the best way to do things. But a lot of people don't do this, and usually the reason they don't do it is because they're behind. It doesn't make sense to study tomorrow's lecture when you haven't even studied yesterday's lecture. And the way I get around this is I just never fall behind. I'm just perfect, I never make any mistakes, and therefore I'm never behind. I'm obviously joking, I'm behind almost constantly. So I actually make the decision to do tomorrow's lecture even when I haven't done yesterday's lecture. Now, I know that might seem kind of weird and disorganized, but if you have a good way to keep track of what you have and haven't learned, it's probably the best way to do things. Pre-studying for a lecture is the best way to learn the information. So I don't think giving up on that makes any sense just because you're behind on other lectures. Plus, for me personally, doing things this way has actually prevented me from falling further behind. When you're constantly doing the lectures you're most behind on, you're also constantly going to be catching up. And that becomes really discouraging after a while. Whenever I can't get to a lecture and I fall behind on it just because I don't have enough time, I leave that one behind. I focus on what's tomorrow and I try to stay caught up with that. Then eventually there's gonna come a time, maybe on a weekend or maybe a day off, where I'm gonna have time to go back and catch that lecture that I missed before. Now, moving on to the last two steps. These two steps only really matter if your school is not pass-fail. That's because these two steps are focused on learning the information that's covered in your lecture, but isn't covered in third-party resources. I'd say third-party resources and lectures in my school personally overlap by about 90%. But there's always gonna be information in your lectures that isn't covered in the textbook or other third-party resources. Now, if your school is pass-fail, this really isn't an issue. By doing just the third-party resources and studying based off of those, and then just attending your lectures, you're gonna do much, much better than just pass. But if your program is graded, and you're looking for those extra few percentage points, these last two steps might be worthwhile. Now, the first of these two steps is to make Anki cards based on the things that the lecture included, but your third-party resources missed. At my school, a good example of this tends to be the epidemiology sections of most lectures. Our lecturers love talking about where certain diseases are found, and that tends to be an area that is not as heavily emphasized in the textbooks or third-party resources. So when I come across a piece of information like this, I'll make sure to make an extra Anki card including that information, so I don't miss out on it when they ask about it in our exams. Because I've already pre-studied a lot of the lecture material, I'm generally pretty relaxed during the lecture. And because of that, I have enough time to create these Anki cards during the lecture. To be honest, it mostly consists of copying and pasting lecture slides and then just using closed deletions to make a bunch of Anki cards. And then the final step, and you can probably guess it, is doing the Anki cards that I made during the lecture. By learning those Anki cards as soon as possible after the lecture, it helps to consolidate that information and really commit it to memory. And then that will add them to my regular Anki review cards, which if I'm doing regularly, will make sure I know that information for my final exams. Now finally comes the question of, should I go to lectures in person? Should I watch the recordings? Or should I even bother going at all? Attending and paying attention to these lectures helps to consolidate the information in ways that are useful beyond just knowing them for your exams. For that reason, I wouldn't recommend skipping your lectures, even if you've already learned that information from a third-party resource. Now, a lot of schools offer the option of watching your lecture recordings after the fact. This can be really useful if you like to watch your lectures on double speed because it can save you a lot of time and may fit in a more flexible schedule. But to be honest, doing things this way means you have to be very strict with yourself and you have to make sure you get your lectures done on time. By going into lectures in person, it forces you to learn new topics at regular intervals during the semester. If you're watching the lectures online at your own pace, it can be really easy to leave all the lectures until much, much later in the semester, and then it all piles up before exams. At the end, it's honestly a personal choice, but just keep in mind that watching the lecture recordings requires a lot more self-control and self-discipline. And that's been my med school workflow. It's worked really well for me throughout my preclinical years of medicine. It's helped me stay caught up, kept me organized, and prevented me from getting overwhelmed. Not to mention, it's helped me perform well on exams. I would really pay attention to the first step especially, just because reviewing your Anki cards on a regular basis as they come up is gonna be really pivotal in making sure you actually commit that information to your long-term memory. That's what's gonna help you do well on your exams. Now, if you like this video, make sure to hit like, subscribe, and the bell icon for notifications next time I release a video. And I will catch you guys on the flippy flip.